Good evening. We are here this evening with one of my all-time favorite writers, Nicholas Meyer. And as Nick, you probably know, I have been a fan of your work ever since, I don't know how long, ever since, I don't know if it's the 7% solution. I don't know if it's when what really kind of excited me was early 80s when I read an interview with you in Rolling Stone where you were talking about both The Day After and Robertson Davies. And one of the things that always impressed me about your work, even before I had ever met you, is your immense intellectual curiosity, your ability to get into the minds of everyone from Sherlock Holmes, who we're talking about, to Houdini, to, you know, God knows who else. So I would like to thank you for taking the time to talk with us this evening. This evening, our focus is going to be this book, which unfortunately is being disappeared by the shadow of the Sphinx behind me, but Nick's latest book, The Return of the Pharaoh. And I also, to the people joining us, I was gonna say, Nick and I will have a conversation. We're gonna talk about his book. I wanna talk about the Pharaoh. I wanna talk about the protocols of the Elders of Zion, which was, you know, Sherlock Holmes's last adventure he had with Nick Meyer. But if anybody has any questions, I'm not going to do it where we're going to stop and break for questions. Just throw them in the chat. You have a chat button down at the bottom of your screen. Throw them there. And I'm not sure if Nick can see it or not, but you know, I will see them. And if you have questions to ask about Nick's life, his work, his films, there's Star Trek, there's Houdini, there's The Deceivers that recently got re-released. So there's a lot to talk about. And we could also talk about Nick's brief foray when I cajoled him into writing a review for the Forward a few years back. Anyway, Nick, thanks so much for joining us and for talking about The Return of the Pharaoh.
Oh, thanks very much. It's a pleasure to be here.
So let's start off with the book. This is the new book. What inspired you to write it? You could put Sherlock Holmes anywhere you wanted in the world. Why did you choose to put him in Egypt with his trusty diarist, Watson? Why Egypt? Why now?
Well, all my answers, I should preface this, are probably long-winded answers because I just can't make them any shorter. But it seems that I don't get ideas very often. And when I do, my ideas mostly stink. Or I rule them out, or I don't like them. What I do is I get other people's ideas. People put ideas in my head. I trip over them. The 7% solution, Sherlock Holmes meets Sigmund Freud, that was an idea that happened very gradually because of a lot of things that went on before it became Holmes meets Freud. It had to do with my father being a shrink and so forth and so on. And in this case, the Return of the Pharaoh was more or less suggested to me by my longtime friend, agent, manager, amanuensis, Alan Gasmer, to whom the book is dedicated. And he said, what about Holmes in Egypt? And that was all it took to prime my pump. And I was off and running. He also suggested some years ago, oh, why don't you write your memoir, which also had not occurred to me, because nothing occurs to me. It has to be sort of poured in from a pitcher elsewhere. And that's how the Return of the Pharaoh got started. The moment he said it, I was off and running. When I worked on Star Trek VI, The Undiscovered Country, with Leonard Nimoy, I didn't have any ideas for it. And he said, well, what about the wall comes down in outer space? And that was all it took, and just off and running, but you have to sort of prime my pump. And so Holmes, what about Holmes in Egypt? And I thought, that is so cool. And it fed into my youthful movie going experience with the land of the pharaohs, the valley of the kings, the Egyptian, all of what we call those spear and sandal movies that I used to watch at the RKO 58th Street before it was replaced by Alexander's, before it was replaced by whatever high skyscraper condo is there now. But that was a movie palace where I ate a great deal of popcorn.
So out of curiosity, you say that the idea was suggested, Egypt, was that like one of 10 suggestions or was that the only one? Were there 90 rejected? Like, was there, you know, let's stick him in Peru. And you said, nah, not so much. And then you hit on Egypt. That was the one to go with.
No, he just said it. It feeds into something else I guess I could add, which is that my Holmesian juices start flowing when I get Sherlock out of England. I think what happens or what is in danger for me of happening is if I stick him in London and it's another case, which I did once, the West End horror, which is, I think, a good one. But to keep on doing that is to perhaps fall into a kind of taxidermy in which things aren't really coming to life. I'm just replicating things that have come before. And I think when I get Sherlock out of town and make him a fish out of Thames water in some other locale, Vienna, Paris, Russia, and now Egypt, he has to call on a different skill set. He has to be more on his game. And there's more chance or excuse or provocation for different colors to come out, at least as I experience writing him. And as a kid, as I started to say, I was always very interested in all that ancient Egyptian stuff and archaeology. And the first screenplay I ever wrote about age 18 or something was The Life of Heinrich Schliemann, for which the world was panting, you may be sure. Schliemann, for your listeners who may or may not know, was the reckless father of archaeology. He was the discoverer of what turned out to be Troy, 10 cities piled one on top of each other in Turkey. I think he misidentified which one was Troy, but his great contribution was that he was the first person apparently who came up with the notion that myths and legends might have their origin in some kind of fact, that Camelot might have been a real place, that Ilium, which is the city of Troy, that Troy is the capital of, might have been a real place. And working from that premise, and a lot of archaeologists after him have found themselves working from that premise. So yeah, I was always interested in archaeology. I was interested reading about Howard Carter and so forth. And Holmes' 1911 Egypt, that was catnip.
So whatever happened to The Mad Adventures of Heinrich Schliemann, the first screenplay, did that go anywhere? Is it still in a drawer somewhere? Is it in the Iowa archives?
Oh, it might be in the Iowa archives at the University of Iowa where my papers are kept. And somewhere I've probably got the screenplay. And I have all my books about Schliemann, and there are numerous books about him. And one of the most curious is that Schliemann snuck the treasure that he found, the treasure incidentally large enough to pay off the national debt of Greece. He smuggled it out of Turkey from the overseers who were determined to see that he did nothing of the kind. He got it back to Athens, and eventually it wound up in Berlin, where it disappeared. And for many years, it was largely assumed that the Russians had got hold of it when they entered Berlin before the Allies at the end of the Second World War. And the Russians neither confirmed nor denied this. But I don't know, about 25 years ago, a coffee table book came out, and I've got the book, and it's got all the treasure. They had it all the time.
That leads me to wonder, like, how much research goes into these Holmes novels? Because one of the things that, at least, it's been a while since I've read West End Horror or 7% Solution, but the last two, which you've written pretty quickly after each other, there seems to be such kind of a joy and effortlessness to it. And yet, like, there's so much erudition and so much research that must go into it. So can you talk a little bit about the process of, is it all coming out of your head, or are you sitting there with piles of book? I mean, I see—
Or out of some other orifice. The truth is that I'm very fond of Victorian and Edwardian prose. And I'm sort of steeped in those words and those locutions. I'm very comfortable with them. And having read a lot and written a lot of Holmes stuff at this point, that language comes more naturally to me than it might to somebody else. So lay that in as a sort of groundwork. Having said that, there is an enormous amount of research that went into the return of the Pharaoh. And it had to do in a whole separate sort of disciplines and areas. Number one, ancient Egypt. I had to learn about the 18th dynasty, which also means a little bit before and a little bit after. I had to learn about the age and the construction of pyramids and when they gave that up. It only lasted about a century, pyramid construction, because pyramids were like enormous advertisements pointing to where the gold was. And so almost immediately, the guy inside was dead. People were, you know, chipping away. And they were probably the first set of guards. There's actually a Latin expression, who will guard the guards? In 1979, speaking of research, I was in Egypt and I went into the Great Pyramid. And you go in through the robber's entrance. It's not for the claustrophobic, I might add. And you're climbing uphill in a very narrow place that's made by a million chisels. Those guys were not robbing that pyramid for themselves. They were robbing it for their great-grandchildren. They had all the time in the world. So ancient Egypt, and in particular, the pharaohship of a peculiar guy named Akhenaten. Akhenaten is the only pharaoh whose personality or psychology we know anything about. All the rest of them are essentially interchangeable. But Akhenaten was the first monarch pharaoh to get an idea in his head that all the Egyptian gods, Osiris and Ra and Horus, all those guys were wrong, that there was only one god, and it was the sun, which he called the Aten. Hence, he took the name Akhenaten. And he worshiped that, and he insisted that everybody else abandon the pantheon of gods and only worship the Aten, the result of which was that Egypt was plunged into a civil war. And when Akhenaten was dead, all his images were erased, chiseled out of whatever stone, and he had built another city that disappeared into the sands, and it was as if he had never lived. And a lot of people kind of romanticize him as the first, you know, sort of putting him somewhere in a Judeo-Christian tradition, but he really wasn't. He was a fanatic, and if you didn't worship his one god, well, maybe he is in the Judeo-Christian tradition. He got very angry. Anyway, so I had to research Egypt before him, during him, after him. Then I had to research modern Egypt, which is to say Egypt in 1911, when the novel is set. And the novel, during that time, Egypt was part of the crumbling Ottoman or Turkish Empire, even then known as the sick man of Europe. And World War I would lead to the end of that particular empire. But at the time, they more or less controlled Egypt. Their only rival for that control was the British government that ran Egypt as a kind of colony in all but name. And their main concern in keeping tight hold on Egypt was control of the Suez Canal, which was really important. So there's a lot of geopolitics pre-World War I was the second area that I had to research. And the third area was sort of a medical area, because the novel, as your readers will discover, involved tuberculosis, which was then largely, I think, called consumption. And so when did x-rays come into use, and what did they look like, and so forth. And those were the principal areas that I had to familiarize myself with.
Yeah, but all that, you have to do all that, but also in some way, either forget about it or background it. So it's because ultimately it's an adventure you're writing. So all of it's informed by this research, but you know, you're not footnoting every sentence as you go on.
The temptation to footnote it, by the way, was something I really had to resist. I mean, there are footnotes in the book that are presumably by me and not by Watson. And sometimes superfluous displays of irrelevant erudition were uncalled for, and they break up the narrative. When we did the audio version of the book, which is wonderfully read by an actor named David Robb, who plays the doctor on Downton Abbey, and the long, wonderful voice, I was doing the footnotes. And I just thought, no, I gotta eliminate even more of them here, because it just busts up the flow of the narrative. I think research, whether you're in as it relates to any work of art, whether it's a play or a movie or I don't know what, is a little bit analogous, or should be analogous, to scene painting, which is to say, only what's on stage and what the audience can see is relevant. What goes off into the wings, no one needs to know about. So, despite how much fun I was having learning about stuff, and what the difference between Greek and Egyptian names for pharaohs was, you got to cut out a lot of that stuff and remember that a narrative is more or less like a shark. It has to keep moving or it drowns, it dies. So you have to get rid of some things that seem very cool to you at the time.
And I'm assuming you were writing this during the pandemic, I would guess. So they're not
in
Egypt that are happening. So it's all from the comfort or discomfort of your home, as it may be, I would assume.
Well, that's the writer's habitat anyway. The discomfort of my home, or as you say, the comfort of it. You look up and you've been in ancient Egypt or you've been in modern Egypt, and hours have gone by and you've done okay in terms of your own sort of psychological well-being.
We have a question in the chat, which I'm not sure if you can see. I'm just going to ask you. I'm also going to invite our readers. I'm not sure if they're going to do this or not, but everyone who's listening, you heard Nicholas say that sometimes he gets his best ideas from just someone, preferably his agent, telling him where a best place to set a Sherlock Holmes novel would be. If anyone has an idea, why don't they put it in the chat and we can see what you think of it. So
later I'll be sued.
Yeah, well, I can't cover you there. But here's a question from Jamie Statlin, and it's rather lengthy, so I will say it slowly. He says, or she says, one of your hallmarks has been pairing famous historical contemporaries together in fictional settings, Holmes and Freud, Jack the Ripper, and H.G. Wells. It seems to me that you do something very similar in Wrath of Khan by interfacing the words and ideas of Charles Dickens and Herman Melville throughout the film. Can you speak to that? How you landed on those two authors, and if it was challenging to weave in themes from texts as disparate as A Tale of Two Cities and Moby Dick?
Yeah, that question I can actually answer for change. When I was talking with Harv Bennett and Robert Salen, who were the producers of what became Star Trek II, The Wrath of Khan, I didn't know much about Star Trek at all. I had not watched the show. And when I was shown these episodes, typical me, I didn't understand anything I was seeing. And I remember we were in my living room, what we'll call my living room. Anyway, I was wandering around the room talking to them. And I said, does anybody ever light a cigarette in the 23rd century? Or is that like gone? Or does anybody ever read a book? How come no one ever reads a book? And I pulled down by merest chance the Tale of Two Cities, which was the novel that everybody knows the first and last lines of, regardless of whether they read what's in the middle. And it just stayed with me that was the book I pulled down. And that's how it wound up in the screenplay when I wrote it, when he gets a birthday present from, when Kirk gets a birthday present from Spock. The reason that Melville, and for that matter, Milton, and some other folks made it into the movie on Khan's library shelf is that in the movie, Khan has previously been exiled onto CD Alpha 5, and he presumably, when Kirk set him and his rebellious followers on this Eden-like planet, which at the time was an Eden-like planet, he probably gave him access to the library aboard the Enterprise and said, you know, you want to take some books with you, that's okay. And what books, I thought, would Khan take with him? A fallen angel, a Lucifer in exile. Well, yes, Paradise Lost. Yes, if he views Kirk as his white whale, his nemesis, probably a copy of Moby Dick. So both the Dickens and those other books wound up in the movie from different directions, different origins. I often think, and I don't know if this is good or bad or just is, that I write and I make movies and books for people who read, and I cannot escape my own literary illusion making.
We have a suggestion that you should send Sherlock Holmes to Israel. Thoughts?
There was no Israel.
Okay. That takes care of that one. Tokyo? Is that a suggestion? Okay. I don't think you like this game. The other suggestion is, I once interviewed Umberto Eco, and he told me he passed, but he told me that he liked to set his novels in the places where he would like to take a trip to. So I asked him why he had set this novel in a certain place, and he said, yeah, I felt like going there. So that's why I set a novel there.
I know actors who accept roles in movies for that reason, that they would like to go. I have an idea for another Holmes novel, and depending how well this one sells, it'll determine, I guess, whether I get to write it. And I won't say where it is, but it seems to me a sort of inevitable destination. I'll leave it at that.
Okay. I mean, I guess the something that struck me, and again, this, you could file this into the ideas that you politely discard or ignore, but it struck me that you did the film Time After Time, which had H.G. Wells time traveling, and you've done a number of Holmes novels, but you've never seemed to be tempted to put Holmes in the time machine. Would you ever be tempted to stick him in there and put him somewhere, different time, different place?
Well, I put him in different places. I'm not sure.
Right, that's true. That's true.
I relish the idea of putting him in different times. I have to say, and again, this is, you know, just me shooting off my mouth. I think I'm a purist where Holmes is concerned. I don't really like most Sherlock Holmes movies. I couldn't stand the Basil Rathbone, Nigel Bruce things, because Nigel Bruce was not Watson as I understood him. He was a sort of a buffoon, a jerk. And I never understood why a genius hangs out with a jerk. I thought Holmes's vanity is surely too great, and he is vain, to want the plaudits of somebody who's not very smart. And so I didn't like those movies. And sticking him in World War II, that was sort of out of his chronology for me. So I didn't like that. I like him in his own time frame. I can see him, you know, operating. We know he operated up until 1914 because I read his last bow. And he's been the previous 2 years in America up to that, working undercover as an Irish sympathizer. So I kind of stick very closely to Holmes as I read him as a kid, as Doyle wrote him. Yes, I make changes. I expunge things that I think modern readers won't, you know, like sort of glancing casual anti-Semitism or racism. But I retained his sometime addiction to cocaine, and I try to stay with what it was. I was offered many years ago to work on a movie called Young Sherlock Holmes. And I met the producer and I said, what's it about? And he said, oh, it's about how Holmes and Watson met in high school. And I said, no, they didn't. And so I didn't do it.
Did you see that film? How was that film? I never saw it.
Me neither.
Oh, okay. All right then. We actually have a couple more questions. I kind of like this idea from Natalie Rosinski, where she wants to put Holmes and young Joseph Conrad on the Congo River. I think that's an interesting idea.
Well, it's more interesting than you know. I don't know if your readers or listeners have heard of Roger Casement. Adam, does that mean anything to you, Roger Casement?
I believe I hear his ghost beating on the door.
On the casement window.
That's a poem by, what's his name? William Butler Yeats, who has a poem about Roger Casement.
Does he?
Yeah.
Well, for those of your listeners who are unfamiliar, Joseph Conrad was in the Congo, where he met and crossed paths with an Anglo-Irish journalist by the name of Roger Casement, whom he admired greatly. And he had good reason to admire Roger Casement, as the rest of the world did, because Roger Casement was the first white man to get out of King Leopold's Belgian Congo hell in one piece and tell the astonished and appalled world what Leopold was doing in the way of genocide in that Belgian colony and cutting off people's hands and stuff. You just read Vachel Lindsay, The Congo, and you'll get the general picture. And so Roger Casement was knighted, and Conrad was very proud to know Roger Casement. He was knighted for services to humanity by Queen Victoria for having exposed the atrocities in the Congo, except that when the First World War broke out, Roger Casement revealed a streak of latent Irish patriotism. He was in America before 1914, talking with the enormous Irish-American population about Ireland's chance, now that England was at war, to make a bid for its own independence. And he, in fact, this same Roger Casement, went to Germany in 1914 and tried to convince Irish POWs in German prison camps to come back into the war on the German side. And even the Germans couldn't quite figure that one out. So they put him on a U-boat back to Ireland, where he was instantly arrested, put on trial, and sentenced to hang for treason by the same government which had previously knighted him. And through people like Conrad, and I might add, other admirers, Arthur Conan Doyle among them, who were ardent defenders of his. And what may have finally sealed the deal and his fate were the discovery of his diaries, the so-called Black Diaries of Roger Casement, in which, among other things, he was revealed to be a kind of a promiscuous homosexual. And that was, you know, as it had been for Oscar Wilde before him, the kiss of death, and this in Casement's case, literally. Some people think that the British government forged those diaries or those entries, which seems a little preposterous to me, although it feels like a Saturday Night Live skit, some guy inserting porno passages into Casement's other entries. I don't quite see how it works. But anyway, Conrad and Doyle and George Bernard Shaw were ardent defenders of Casement and said, this is a terrible shame. But Casement did hang, and he did know Conrad, and he was in the Congo. And as I say, because Doyle also knew Casement, there is a kind of connection in your listener's suggestion.
Yeah, okay. That opened up a whole window that I had not expected. I'm curious, you spoke about Conan Doyle, you just mentioned, and we have a watcher, I guess you would say, who are watching on Zoom, who asks about, since this is, after all, the foreword, what are the instances of anti-Semitism in Conan Doyle? Are there, do you notice any trace of it in his work?
Yes, there's not a lot. And I think it's a sort of automatic. He tells Watson, I think, that he obtained his Stradivarius. He plays the violin, that he got his Stradivarius from a Jew peddler in Tottenham Court Road. I don't think normally when you go to buy a violin, you specify the religion of the person you bought it from, but, or at least you could have said a Jewish or a Hebrew, but he says a Jew peddler. And later on, I can't remember whether it's Holmes or Watson, describes somebody as having something of the sheeny about him, which also seems to me to be a not very pleasant reference. And he also, in one of the worst Doyle stories, Holmes has a series of exchanges with a black man who's clearly some kind of thug. And there are a lot of racist taunts thrown at this guy by Holmes, including some reference to what he smells like, that are not fun to read.
But in the grand scheme of his oeuvre, let us say, it seems like it, in comparison to other authors perhaps of the period, it seems like a relatively small percentage.
I think it is a small percentage. You know, all works of art and all people are ineluctably products of the times in which they were either created or the times in which they find themselves. I think, by the way, also in the Sherlock Holmes stories, there's a story called The Yellow Face, in which Holmes seems to recognize, tolerate, maybe approve as too much of a thing, but he encounters the child of an interracial marriage. And he does not appear judgmental about that at all. in my recollection.
And was, I assume the answer to this is no, but was your impetus to write the previous book about the protocols of the elders of Zion a little bit wanting to write the record of Holmes in some way to see how he would behave in the face of an anti-Semitic document?
I think it's possible. I have said elsewhere that artists, A, are not the best judges of what they're doing or even what they've done. My favorite example of this, it's a little long-winded, is that when Socrates is told by the oracle at Delphi that he's the wisest man in Greece, his first reaction is, well, that can't be right. And in order to disprove the oracle, all I need to do is talk to people who are wiser than I. So he goes to all segments of Greek society and eventually gets around to the poets. And he thinks those people who write so acutely or paint or sculpt so wonderfully about the human condition and human beings, that they're probably wiser than, they're bound to be wiser than I am. And he says to his surprise, the poets were the stupidest people he talked to. They were like children. They made no sense, except when they did their art. And when they did their art, they went into a kind of trance, during which time they take dictation from God. And this they call inspiration. And when it's all over, they come out of it and they go back to being children again with no real knowledge and less insight into what's just gone down. And I think when I'm working, I go into my own trance. I'm sure I'm not the only one who has experienced this. And later analyzing it, certainly for me to analyze it, I sort of distrust it. There's a great temptation to work backwards and justify or rationalize or turn into anecdotes, you know, which I'm not sure how useful or how accurate it is. W.S. Gilbert was asked how he wrote the Mikado. And he said, well, there was a Japanese sword hanging over my desk and it fell down and it almost decapitated me. And that's where I got the idea for the Mikado. And I thought, well, this is a really good story. Maybe it's too good. And in any case, it doesn't really explain how he wrote the Mikado. I think, or what I recollect was on my mind when I was writing The Adventure of the Peculiar Protocols was Donald Trump and fake news. And viewing the protocols as an early instance, maybe not the earliest, of fake news.
Again, I taking at your word that you're not the most reliable source for talking about your own work, giving that as a given, I mean, how much of your writing of Sherlock Holmes is informed by the fact that you do have a Jewish background? Is there anything, does that inform Holmes or any of your other characters in any way, would you say? Again, you may have to make up some of your answer. I understand that.
I am a Jew. There's no question about it in my mind or anybody else's. I am not an observant Jew. I am not a fan of organized religion. But I am omnipresently Jewish somewhere in my head. I don't escape it. I relate to the world through 5,000 years of Jewish consciousness or whatever. I've never done 23andMe. I don't even know how Jewish I am, if you want to go that route. But I, you know, I can go back to about 1830 and we seem to be pretty Jewish. And I think because that's true, I can't help thinking, seeing, perceiving, and writing a lot of stuff with that as part of my DNA, my intellectual DNA, my aesthetic DNA, whether my family, my parents, my shrink father and my concert pianist mom were resolutely sort of irreligious. They were not as interested in all of this as I became. Did I become more interested because I saw the Ten Commandments? Did I become more interested because my playmate on the block where I grew up was a little Catholic boy whose parents ran the candy store on the corner? And so we got into a lot of theological discussions, with which he was at a distinct advantage because he went to a religious school. And he said, you know, we were, you know, and I'm like 7 years old or something, we were damned because we didn't accept Jesus. And I was overheard to say, well, we're Jewish and we believe in wolves. You know, so I wanted to learn something about this because he knew more. So I said to my parents, you know, I want to go to Sunday school like Johnny Bendick. So knowing my parents, I got sent to this chicest Sunday school in Manhattan. I went to Temple Emmanuel on 65th and Fifth Avenue, I believe. And I lasted, I guess, about 6 weeks. I was expelled. And I'm told that I was expelled because the teacher was saying something. And I said, I don't believe that. And what's more, I don't think you do either. And so I was gone. But it whetted my appetite to learn about Moses and the Old Testament. And I started learning all about it. There was a comic book about Moses that I remembered lying in bed and weeping about Moses that he didn't get to cross the Jordan. And later on, I worked on a movie about Moses. I worked on this animated movie, The Prince of Egypt. And there were a lot of people working on this movie. And I was the one who had actually read the five books and you know, said interesting, they were interesting to me. I said, does anybody here know or care that Moses is a murderer? And they went, whoa, who'd he murder? And he said, well, it says he's murdered an Egyptian overseer. There was a tick of silence and somebody said, oh yeah, he was like beating a slave. And somebody else goes, no, not just a slave, his mother, you know, and they were spinning this rationale. I said, yeah, but it's not what it said in the book. In the book, it says it's premeditated. Yeah, it says he looked both ways. And when he was done, he buried the body in an earthen pit. That isn't quite the crime of passion that you're setting up for. Anyway, so I did my homework.
You got expelled from The Prince of Egypt?
No, I stayed on that movie. But it was interesting because my other great moment on that film, which isn't in the movie, of course, is we were working on the scene where Moses comes down from the burning bush and tells his wife, Sephora, that he has to go back to Egypt. And, you know, when I nominated him as a murderer, I thought, you know, this is good. This is unfinished business. He has to go back. And we went round and round. What does he say in that scene? What does he tell his wife? He has to go back. And I said, how about this? Comes down, he goes, I have to go back to Egypt. And Sephora says, why do you got to go back? And he says, because God told me to. And she says, do you believe in God? And he says, it doesn't matter. God believes in me. And I thought, yes, this is why you get paid millions of dollars. They didn't. Jeffrey Katzenberg worried that it would be blasphemous, so it's not in the movie. I put it in another movie someplace else. It's in The Count of Monte Cristo with Richard Harris. Never throw anything away.
Okay, I'm gonna be looking for that very shortly. We have about 5 minutes left. And if anyone has any other additional questions, please put them in the chat. I was gonna ask you about going back to the Pharaoh book and protocols, actually. You mentioned that you write books for people who read, and they're always kind of, if you're looking carefully, there's a literary reference, but I think you also write books for people who love movies as well. And I recall in Protocols, there was kind of a fairly significant reference to The Lady Vanishes by Hitchcock. And in The Return of the Pharaoh, I certainly detected like a little bit of Agatha Christie and Murder on the Orient Express in there, a character who seemed to have gone from one film into your book. Is that true?
Well, I think I'm sometimes sloppy or hasty in picking names. I picked the name Arbuthnot just because I liked the name, and it didn't occur to me that I was stepping into a whole train of associations that was not going to be doing me much good. That's number one. Number two is, yes, I am I'm a movie fanatic. I grew up wanting to make movies and was lucky enough to be able to do it. And so, yeah, I have sort of one foot in each camp. In the Protocols, there's definitely a very deliberate homage to The Lady Vanishes, which is a favorite Hitchcock movie of mine. And I sort of did my own riff on it. I like Sherlock on Trains. I don't know why, but I think that's kind of cool.
Like trains in general.
I do like trains. Yeah, I think they're very romantic. You know, planes, you're sitting up in an aluminum tube 36,000 feet up in the thing, you know, looking at some movie on the back of someone's chair, and I go, help, help.
Someone wants to know, what's the status of your con miniseries?
Gosh, I wish I knew. I wrote a three-night, I was originally commissioned to write a three-night mini-series, limited series, trilogy about Khan on CD Alpha 5 before his accidental rescue by Terrell and Chekhov in the story. And I thought I had done a really terrific job. Again, I'm not the best judge, but I thought this is really good. And nothing ever happened with it, and I don't know why. The closest I got to an explanation was that the streaming movie business was evolving so quickly that by the time I turned in what I had written, a three-hour event was not enough, a three-night event. It had to be, they wanted something longer. And I said, well, yeah, okay, so we'll make it longer. But that didn't happen. And I don't know why. I've never learned why.
Okay. So before we leave you tonight, first, I just want to thank you for joining us. I have one final thing to ask you, but I want everyone who's listening or watching, however you consume your Zoom content, to pick up The Return of the Pharaoh. It is incredibly, like, your two books in the past couple of years have been some of the most entertaining hours I've spent with books. So I thank you for that. Thank you for joining the forward. And since you are such a movie buff and such a reader, can you send us home with a couple book and movie recommendations? What are you reading? What are you watching? What should we be reading and watching in the comfort of our own homes or discomfort?
Well, the one thing I will tell you that you don't stay in your home to see it is go to see the Steven Spielberg movie of West Side Story, which is an exhilarating, terrific experience, but don't watch it on your smartphone. You got to see it with popcorn and the whole nine yards. It's really, I went in with a chip on my shoulder. I didn't think I was going to like it, but I was blown away. That's the first thing. And gosh, that, you know, if I start recommending books, I'll never stop. But I'll recommend one book, and it's a great big book called Wagnerism, Art and Politics in the Shadow of Music by Alex Ross, who was the music critic for The New Yorker, as some of your listeners may know. And doesn't matter whether you know Wagner, or whether you like Wagner, or whether you have ever heard his music. That's not what the book is about. The book is about the reach of Richard Wagner. And the thesis is that all modernity, sexual, social, philosophical, aesthetic, political, cultural, all comes from Wagner, all modernism. And he makes a pretty good case. It's intellectual popcorn. You can read it from start to finish, which I did, don't ask why, or you can just dip in here and there, but it's good stuff.
So since it's a conversation with Nick Meyer, we have covered Wagner, Spock, Holmes, Leonard Bernstein, and God knows what else. So thank you so much for taking the time, and thanks everyone for watching, and look forward to your next book. And you can't tell
Adam,
us.
Adam, thank you so much. Thank you for having me. I really mean it. I had a good time. Hope somebody else did.
We hope so too. All right. Have a great rest of your day.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.